Well, greetings, church family. Today's daily Bible reading had us in 2 Samuel chapters 15 and 16. And in chapter 15, verses 1 through 12, we see Absalom left undisciplined by his father, King David, zero repercussions for his evil deeds, at least thus far. He's emboldened to slowly position himself to try and take the kingdom for himself. So he works the crowd, each crowd that visits Jerusalem. He flatters, he lies, he uses all sorts of manipulative language to endear himself to the people of Israel. Even deceives his own father into thinking that Absalom has a vow that he has to fulfill in Hebron. And it's a ruse that allows Absalom to send out spies to continue his conspiracy until he even nabs David's counselor, Ahithophel, to serve the king's wayward son. I mean, Absalom is a consummate politician, and it seems to work, at least for the time being. Of course, God, who is sovereign, working behind the scenes to ensure that David, his anointed one, will remain as king. Verse 7, notice that if you're in the NASB or King James or New King James, you'll see 40 years. This is based on the ancient Hebrew Masoretic text, but there are ancient translations of this text, Greek, Syriac, Latin, which read 4 years instead. And that's why the ESV and the NIV, the Holman Christian Standard Bible, they all say 4 years. And it's important for us to understand, is it 40 years? Is it 4 years? Because remember, David ruled over Israel for 40 years until his death. And both the rest of 2 Samuel and 1 Kings 1 show that David is going to continue to rule after Absalom's death. So this can't be the 40 years of David's reign. And it can't be, if it is, the reading is 40 years, it can't be a literal 40 years here. It has to be a metaphor. Ronald Youngblood takes the view that the translations into Greek and Syriac and Latin have it correct, which is 4 years. David Samura, these are just a couple commentators I wanted to make sure I cited, he looks at Ezekiel 29:13 and then looks back at the Exodus and states that the term 40 years is referring to a kind of formulaic phrase to metaphorically refer to the completion of a certain amount of time, because Israel was in the wilderness for 40 years. That seems like a little bit of a stretch to me at the moment. I would say that 4 years is the accurate reading. In any case, what we see here is that there's been a completion of some time, right? Absalom's been working away at this, and we do know that David is going to reign past Absalom's failed rebellion. In chapter 15, verses 13 through 37, we see that thankfully, of course, again, the Lord is working behind the scenes. David does hear about this civil war that's nearing. It allows him to escape Jerusalem safely. And note that he has three important groups of people that are remaining faithful to the anointed king of Israel. First, we have a military group, his foreign mercenaries, the Cherethites and Pelethites and Gittites, right, from Gath. They all remained faithful to him because he was their wise commander in battle, and he took good care of them in battle. The high priest Zadok, we get a religious group that is going to be faithful to David. High priest Zadok, all the priests and other Levites, they show their faithfulness to the king because they have a faithfulness to the will of the Lord, who has anointed David as king and not Absalom. And then you have a real personal connection here, David's close friend Hushai, and he's actually going to work on David's behalf from within Jerusalem, even from within Absalom's phony court that he sets up. We get an interlude at the beginning of chapter 16, verses 1 through 4 with Ziba. That's that servant of the house of Saul that David commanded to work the fields to provide for Jonathan's crippled son Mephibosheth earlier in the book. But we're going to find out later on in chapter 19, verses 24 through 30, this claim by Ziba that Mephibosheth wants to take the kingdom for himself, that it's a false one. The servant actually lied to Mephibosheth and David both in order to gain riches for himself. Chapter 16, verses 5 through 14, David interacts with another member of Saul's household, and he shows real humility and patience with this Shimei, patience that he's actually going to continue to show to him after Absalom's rebellion is put down. We'll see that in chapter 19, verses 16 through 23. And really, this is just a great example of David not being easily offended. This is an important principle for us as Christians, that we would take the Lord seriously, that we would take his word seriously, that we would take holiness seriously, but that we wouldn't take ourselves too seriously, in the sense of, again, we want to take our own sin seriously, repent of it, turn to the Lord. We want to take holiness seriously. We do not want to be easily offended by people. Sometimes we get those looks or those lack of communication or over communication or miscommunication, and we might take that to an extreme and think, oh no, this person is against me. I'm so upset. I'm bitter now against them. We need to follow David's example here. Not be easily offended. This guy's hurling curses at him, Shimei is. Well, the rest of the chapter, 16, 15 through 23, we get Absalom and his rebellious troops. They do seize Jerusalem for themselves without any fighting, as David has left with his troops. And there is a bit of a fulfillment here in verse 31 at the end of the chapter, of David's prayer in verse 31 of chapter 15, when he asks the Lord, essentially, may the Lord make sure that Ahithophel's counsel is going to be bad, right? And he does give some bad counsel to Absalom regarding David's concubines that the king left behind to kind of take care of his house and his property. The counsel he gives is extremely immoral, and it could easily have consequences among the people that would not benefit David's son. Well, one big principle here that we see is the flattery and the deceptive words, the verbal manipulation that Absalom used here. These are things that the Lord hates, and they do indeed fail to secure Absalom the kingdom. God's word actually makes clear that such actions will have consequences. In fact, in Psalm 12, 2 through 4, we read, they speak falsehood to one another with flattering lips, and with a double heart they speak. May Yahweh cut off all flattering lips, the tongue that speaks great things, who have said, with our tongue we'll prevail, our lips are our own. Who is Lord over us? That is definitely Absalom's attitude here. And you and I are prone to this as well because of our sinful nature, to think we could just talk our way through this instead of what does the Lord will. And notice, even David, when he's having these abuses hurled at him, these curses by Shimei, what does he say? Well, maybe the Lord's told him to say this to me, right? He gives him the benefit of the doubt and thinks maybe this is God's will for this to occur at this point. Now, why is God so opposed to flattery and verbal manipulation and other devious uses of the tongue? Because it is sin. It's the complete opposite of the Lord's own holiness, which is reflected in His Word. In fact, Psalm 12 goes on to contrast the evil uses of the tongue with the purity of God's own words. In Psalm 12, 6 through 7, the words of Yahweh are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace on the earth, refined seven times. You, O Yahweh, will keep them. You will preserve him from this generation forever. Another big principle we're seeing with Absalom is just the consequence of not nipping wickedness in the bud. The consequence of a father and king, a leader, not disciplining his son. David was not the most faithful father. In fact, in 1 Kings 1, 5 and 6, in reference to another son, Adonijah, we get some of his unfaithful parenting. That son later will say, I will be king, and he exalts himself. And so he prepared for himself chariots and horsemen with 50 men to run before him. His father had never crossed him at any time by asking, why have you done so? And it's not a stretch of the imagination to say David most likely acted the same way towards Absalom from when he was young. And again, we see in 2 Samuel 14, 33, he failed to give even the lightest of disciplines for Absalom, who had ordered the murder of his half-brother and had burned up Joab's fields. In Ephesians 6, 4, we read, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Disciplining our children out of anger or hatred will certainly provoke them to anger, but also failing to lovingly discipline our children with instruction, that's a recipe for disaster and can lead to a hateful lifestyle where they will be against the Lord in anger. Proverbs 13, 24 says, he who withholds his rod hates his son, but he who loves him disciplines him diligently. And even as we think about that, fathers, and we take a close watch over how we are disciplining and instructing our children, we need to also praise the Lord for his discipline and instruction of those that he has saved by his grace through our repentant faith in his son, Christ Jesus. If you're a Christian, praise God that he disciplines us and instructs us, and this causes us to continue to trust in him and grow in righteousness, right? Faithfulness towards God and how we live. Hebrews 12, 7 through 11 is where we'll leave this morning. It is for discipline that you endure. God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? But if you are without discipline, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Furthermore, we had earthly fathers to discipline us, and we respected them. Shall we not much rather be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time as seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good, so that we may share his holiness. All discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful, but sorrowful. Yet to those who have been trained by it, afterwards it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. May that be true in our lives, that we would accept the discipline of the Lord when we need it, to repent from our sin and turn to Him with faithfulness, growing righteousness in our lives. Well, we've been in 2 Samuel. We've been in chapters 15 and 16 this morning. I hope you have a great day.